your time is up. It shall ring a bell when you're done.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Your opening statement.
Well, today's my anniversary, folks. Where's my wife?
Anniversary.
And I want to thank y'all for coming and celebrating the fact that she's put up with me for yet another year. So, thank you. There are three groups here, I figure. The groups that will support, I'm humming, regardless of what I say. There are the group that is supporting me, who I am indebted to, and thank you and congratulate you for hanging in there with me. And then there are some undecideds. But to those of you who are supporting David, I want you to know that if I win this election, I will have an open door policy. I will pull the keypad off the district attorney's office. I will have an open door. I will treat you with dignity and respect. For those who supported me, I have made certain promises to you. Most of you met me. I want you to know I intend to fulfill those promises. And then those of you who are on the fence, I want you to know I've been doing this for 42 years. I will represent you with dignity. I have wisdom and knowledge and a skill set to bring to the table to represent the district attorney's office. I thank you. Ding, ding, ding. Ding.
All right, your first question. Someone once said, whenever you throw dirt, you're always losing ground. My question to each of you is two-part. First of all, why do you feel the need to attack the other candidate by voicing and publishing his shortfalls in this election? Two, as a voter who takes seriously his responsibility to vote, I do my own research on each candidate before I vote. I also greatly dislike mudslinging. With that said, why not spend more time and energy in your campaign telling us why we should vote for you and what you are willing to bring to the district attorney's office?
Well, clearly, I have spent time promoting myself. But let me tell you why I've said what I've said. First of all, I stand by everything I've said about my opponent's record. I have not said one thing about him personally. In fact, I congratulate him for being the district attorney for the last 8 years. What I have said are matters that affect his record. I have quoted only statistics. I've stated only the facts about what's occurred. If he was doing the job that he was elected to do, then I wouldn't be standing. So I appreciate the fact that some of you think it's mudslinging. I believe if you tell the truth and you state facts, that is not mudslinging. Now, as far as myself, I have in the last few weeks promoted only my qualifications. I have only addressed a positive campaign and told you what I can and will do. In fact, I have a 10-point plan that I intend to introduce at closing, explaining what I will do to make the district attorney's office better.
Well, that leads right into the second question, which is, why do you believe you're more qualified to prosecute cases in Hardin County than your opponent?
I don't believe I am. I am. I don't know if some of you may say that. I'm not arrogant. I'm confident. Let me tell you, and I'm going to have to tell you this, because now some people are going to say, well, now you're mudslinging. Let me tell you what's happened in the last 2 years in that office. In the last 2 years, they have lost 30% of the cases that they've tried. I've never lost 30% of the cases I've tried as a defense lawyer, much less as a prosecutor. So I'm going to put a stop to that. Second, in the last 2 years, he's dismissed 427 cases out of 1,300, 35%. That will stop. If I charge someone with an offense through my office, I will try the case and I will convict the person. And the nonsense of somebody getting off 70%, 30% of the time is going to stop.
Thank you. The next question, how would you address the perceived disconnect between the sheriff's office, police departments, and the DA's office?
I've talked about the disconnect for 2 months. And by disconnect, what I'm talking about is there is no relationship between the district attorney's office and law enforcement. Cases are dismissed, cases are not prosecuted, and the officers don't know why. They don't have a relationship with the district attorney's office so that they are trained and taught in school how to investigate, how to preserve evidence, and how to testify. Those are things that have to be done in order for law enforcement to do their job. And if you've got a frustrated officer on the street who thinks his case doesn't matter to the district attorney, then he's not going to do his job. The other thing that I intend to do is have what's called boots on the ground or on-call prosecutors and investigators. It's done by the U.S. Attorney's Office. It's done by Jefferson County in serious major crimes. They are available to assist law enforcement on the scene so that mistakes are not made.
Thank you. Your next question. Recently, there has been a lot of talk about the large number of cases that have been reported to the state from the DA's office. What would you do to reduce the number of pending and dismissed cases in Hardin County?
Well, it depends on what you're talking about pending. My concern is not with the number of cases that are shown as pending on the books. My concern is with the number of dismissals. Since September of 2010, 2 years after, or a year and a half after he took office, he has dismissed 1,397 cases. Now, by dismissed, I mean dismissed, gone away, disappeared. My concern is the method, the nature, the way that they're disposed of, not the cases pending. Cases have to be, if they're indicted, they have to be followed through. If someone is indicted for a crime on my watch, then that person is either going to trial or he's going to be convicted. But I will not wholesale dismiss 1,400 cases in the 4 years that I intend at least to be there.
What policies and procedures would you put into place in the district attorney's office to ensure that the cases referred to the office address the requirements needed to move forward for prosecution?
This all goes back to relationships, and there's a number of ways that cases get referred to the district attorney's office. One is through law enforcement itself, directly. Burglaries, robberies, dope dealing, murders, those sorts of things. I will have a staff person and or myself training law enforcement on how to work their cases up so that when they bring us a case, I don't have to send it back and I don't have to reject it and say they know what they've got to do. The other thing is some cases come to the district attorney's office through various child advocacy agencies such as the guardhouse. I'm going to work closely with the guardhouse to make sure that they follow the right criteria in the cases that they present. And if we have cases involving children, sexual assaults of children and or adults, I'm going to liaison with the sexual assault nurse, who is a personal friend of mine, by the way, to make sure that the cases are properly developed and worked up so that when a case is presented to the grand jury and it's indicted, it's ready for trial.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Roebuck, you have 2 minutes for your closing statement.
Well, I have, in an effort to be positive, since I'm...
It's on the floor. Brother, all right. Sure. Okay, your turn.
I have, I got there on the table, and I'm going to send everybody later. I have a 10-point plan, and that plan is as follows. I'm going to improve the relationship with local law enforcement, as I said, with boots on the ground and a better training relationship. I'm going to promote community crime fighting programs. I'm going to be in the community, I'm going to be in the schools, working with law enforcement to make sure that we go in and we have more prevention as opposed to having to come to me and prosecute everything. Crime prevention is more important than crime prosecution. Number three, the current budget is $600,000 plus for the district attorney's office, in addition to grants in the neighborhood of a couple $100,000. Plus, if you include his salary, which the state pays, he's running a $1 million operation. You shouldn't lose 30% of the cases you try with a $1 million budget. So I'm going to cut that back as best I can. I'm going to bring in more income via the use of forfeitures of drug proceeds so that we can your tax dollars are used better. As I said, I'm going to have on-call prosecutors in serious crime. Mr. Sheffield is going to tell you that doesn't work, that it makes prosecutors witnesses. Well, it works in Jefferson County, and it works in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and they have a 98% conviction rate as a result of that. So I think 98% versus 70% is much better. If I indict somebody, I'm going to put dismissing cases wholesale. If I indict somebody, I'm going to be ready for trial. It's that simple. It's a waste of your money to indict folks and not try them. So either, if you're dismissing 1,400 cases, you're either not prepared, or you're indicting people that are innocent. Either way, it's not right. I'm going to increase victim involvement. I'm going to oppose bail bonds for repeat offenders. People that are out on jail, out on bond, and they commit more offenses, I'm going to oppose those persons being out on bond. And I'm going to seize property of drug dealers. People that deal drugs for a living, I'm going to seize the products of those drug dealings, sell those things, and put the money in the coffers.